Hello, and welcome to Software Architecture Monday. My name is Mark Richards. I'm a hands-on software architect and also the founder of developer2architect.com. In today's lesson, lesson 27, I want to talk about the circuit breaker pattern. Let me first talk about a context in which it's needed. And so when we have any sort of service consumer, and that would be either a website or another application, talking remotely to another service or a microservice, we have to deal with two things. We have to deal with availability and also responsiveness. Availability meaning, can I even get to the service? And once I've gotten to the service, am I getting a timely response? And so let's say that we're placing a trade. I'm invoking a place trade operation on this particular microservice, which I'm going to buy 100 shares of Apple stock, let's say. And on average, that comes back in 2,000 milliseconds. Now, I need some sort of timeout value anytime I do a remote call. Now, a lot of times we just make up a number. Well, let's just double the average or something. But here's the problem, which is making up a number. Because what I don't want to have happen is that I time out that transaction right when that service has already placed that trade for 100 shares of Apple and is just about to hand me back a confirmation ID for that, and I time out. So my view of the world is that it was a failed transaction. However, the microservices view of the world is that it actually placed that trade with a broker. As a matter of fact, if it's a market price, it's already probably been executed. And so what happens is, an error, I end up placing another trade. So now I've purchased 200 shares of Apple. Alternatively, I need all sorts of really complex logic in that trading microservice, in that trade placement microservice, to detect duplicate trades. So what should that timeout value be? Well, to kind of cut to the quick, here's a very commonly used algorithm. Ignore the average and take the max time under load in production, which is 5,000 milliseconds. That means at some point, the longest that transaction has ever taken successfully was 5,000 milliseconds. So I take that max time under load and now I double it. But you can see the problem though. 10,000 milliseconds to just determine that there's a problem. That is way too long. And as a matter of fact, every single client, every single trade is waiting that 10,000 milliseconds just to know that there's some sort of responsiveness issue happening with that microservice. This is completely unacceptable. Enter the circuit breaker pattern. Now, the circuit breaker pattern works very similar to the circuit breaker in your home. In other words, it remains closed, allowing electricity to flow to all your appliances and lights and what have you. However, when there's an issue and something bad happens, that breaker immediately opens, blocking all electricity out into that home so that it protects it so it doesn't burn down, let's say. Well, the circuit breaker in software works exactly the same way. And so between the service consumer, either that website or another application, and the microservice, sits the circuit breaker. Now, that circuit breaker is continually monitoring this microservice, and I'm going to talk about that monitoring in a little bit. But everything's healthy with that microservice, and so that broker remains closed. Now, when a request is made, for instance, to place that trade, the service consumer checks with the circuit breaker first, and it says, "Breaker, are you closed?" "Yes." "Okay, then I know that that microservice is responsive, and now I'm safe to make that call." However, when bad things happen to good people, in other words, this microservice becomes non-responsive, this breaker that's constantly monitoring that microservice immediately notifies of that, or gets notified of that, or sees that, and opens. And now, if I want to place a trade, I check with that breaker and say, "Are you closed?" "Nope, I'm open." And an error occurs. Here's the difference. I find out through the circuit breaker that place trade microservice is non-responsive in about 10 milliseconds. Now, think about that. With a timeout, I had to wait 10,000 milliseconds. And so every client that's trying to place a trade finds out that there's an error in 10 milliseconds. That's responsiveness. Now, that breaker is continually still monitoring that microservice to say, "Are you up and running? Are you better?" And when that microservice now becomes responsive, that circuit breaker now closes, therefore allowing all these transactions through. Now let's take a look at this piece about the monitoring, because that really, really kind of determines the type of circuit breaker. And there's three basic types of circuit breakers that you might find. The first is a simple heartbeat. Now these are not very useful for responsiveness, but are useful for availability. In other words, are you accepting requests? And that's really what those heartbeats are. They don't work well with circuit breakers from a responsiveness standpoint, because all I'm determining is that the heartbeat is responsive, but I have no knowledge about the place trade functionality. And so the second type is a synthetic transaction. Now, a synthetic transaction is a fake transaction. In other words, a fake phone number, or in our case, a fake QSIP 9999999, or a fake bank account number or credit card number. And so in this case, the circuit breaker is continually making calls to that place trade functionality with fake numbers so that it can determine the actual responsiveness of that particular operation. Now, there's two problems with synthetic transactions. The first is that every single solitary system, including reporting and all downstream systems, need to know that that number that I just passed in, or that ID, in other words, a QSIP or an account number or a bank account number or a credit card number, is fake. So don't process it. But that leads to the second problem with a synthetic transaction. And that is that I'm only testing generally one path through that place trade. I may not be executing this with a broker. I may not be doing pre-trade compliance validation checks. And so in that case, I'm really not getting a true picture of what's happening with that place trade functionality and the overall response time. So the best and third type is something called real user monitoring. Now here's how it works. What better way to determine the health and responsiveness of any given operation than to actually monitor real transactions? And so these generally don't have timeouts within the circuit breaker, but rather use trend analysis. And so I'm going to throw some numbers out, which is the number of seconds for that response time for a trade, and watch what happens. Are you ready? So the breaker's closed. Are you ready? Let's start placing trades. Here we go. 2.1, 1.6, 1.8, 2.4, 1.5, 1.9, 2.7, 3.6, 4.8, 5.2, open. Did you see what happened? That trend was significantly going up. Now, most of these use standard deviation analysis because there are ups and downs, but that trend went way past 3 standard deviations from the mean. And so in that case, the breaker opened. Now, we have a problem, don't we? Because if that breaker opens, what that means is it's not allowing any requests to that microservice. So how in the world do I determine whether that microservice has become healthy again? And in this case, that's what's called a half-open state. Now, a half-open state means that I'm not going to allow any transactions through except a couple. Maybe, for example, this is all kind of configurable depending on the circuit breaker, but let's say 1 out of every 10 transactions I'm going to allow through. And now in this case, I can start to measure to say, is it responsive? And what was that one? 6.9. Oops, nope, it's still bad. Let's let 9 fail. Let's let 1 through. And what is it now? 1.7. Okay, now we're back to normal and the breaker can close. That's exactly how circuit breakers work. There's a lot of great resources for circuit breakers. Martin Fowler's site, for example, on his Blicky, he has a circuit breaker. And I like this article because at the end, he has pointers and links into GitHub for all sorts of really good circuit breakers in a variety of languages. There's a couple of other resources here, but this was very first introduced in the first edition of Release It by Michael Nygaard, and I provided the link here for you. But that's where Michael Nygaard first kind of introduced this circuit breaker pattern. It's very, very useful, especially in a microservices ecosystem. So this has been Software Architecture Monday. Again, my name is Mark Richards. This has been Lesson 27, The Circuit Breaker Pattern. Stay tuned next week for another lesson in software architecture. Thank you very much.